let's just start right there. Baby Keem is on the program, man. What's up, bro?
How you doing?
I'm chilling, man. It's good to meet you.
I just got the flight, man, so.
From L.A.?
Yeah, from L.A.
Straight to here?
Straight here.
Listening to your production, which is where I want to start the convo before we get into the artist part, because I feel like you've done a lot of work in the production part, which set the stage for the artist part. Am I understanding it right?
Yeah, for sure.
So,
for sure.
And the reason I say that and I tie that to catching a vibe or sipping on something or drinking is, what is, like, how do you zone out when you're trying to create, right? Because some people will say, I zone out. You know, some people might just be like, look, I'll be at the beach listening to the ocean. That's all I need. Or, you know, I drive around and just look at the world. Some people smoke. Some people doing way more than they need to be doing to figure out how to create. What's your thing?
My thing is, like, I don't really leave that mode. Mm. Like, I feel like when I go home, everything I do is for the sake of the music.
Really?
So if I go, like, watch a movie, or if, you know what I'm saying, if I play a video game, I'm studying, like, something. There's something in there that I could use, like, especially, like, a movie, for sure. Like, if I go watch Netflix right now, I'm watching the way it's shot because I want to shoot a music video, or I'm looking at the actors and I'm studying them and they gestures, you know, because I might want to mimic something or you know, just take inspiration of it from it. Or so I kind of just be learning all the time. But you know, I try to have my moments, but it don't really work. I end up getting bored. Like people go on vacations and things like that, and I'm not there yet. And I don't know how to go on a vacation yet.
Yeah, you gotta learn that. And if you come from the hood and y'all never really took vacations before, you don't even know how
that's
to, like,
not a
what
thing
are you talking
for,
about? Like,
yeah, like a vacation for me growing up was like my grandma and my mama and my auntie driving to LA and sleeping on the floor at my auntie's house.
Right.
And like maybe going to the beach or maybe going to see family.
Right, right.
But like that's, and playing with cousins. That's like, that's a vacation to me. So in terms of like leaving this, which is kind of like already a fantasy, like this whole life and just being able to work, it's, and going somewhere to do nothing is kind of tough for me right now.
So you don't, because you said that you don't unplug. So that's your vibe. You're always studying something. That's,
I feel like I'm always wired.
Music. So I mean, looking forward to be like, yo, when I'm 28, you know, when I'm 25, how am I gonna keep up this momentum? But you also are very careful. Like, it doesn't feel like you're, like, you listen to Melodic Blue or the last project, it don't feel like you're in a hurry either to put out mad shit. You're not over-rapping.
Yeah.
You're not rushing to put out, you know, 50 songs in a year type.
Oh, so, for sure. We definitely got some records on the drive that's like, damn, like, those got to see the light. But it's a thing of, like, it got to be the right time. It got to feel right, you know? And that's really how I base it. Especially with Melodic Blue. I was in such an experimental pocket with myself, trying to push myself to limits I didn't really even know I could go. Because I don't want to do the same thing every project. So, and I'm young, and, you know I just started, but I'm trying to do something different every album.
On that, on the first album cover, or the last album, not the first, but the second album, I guess second project, let's call it.
Project.
It looked like some girls was whooping your ass.
Yeah.
Then on this project, the main kind of cover is you sitting on the pier.
Yeah.
But then you got another, like, alternate photo shoot with you and two girls. Is them the same girls that was whooping your ass on the first album cover?
Nah, that would be hard. Nah. The concept of the cover is it's me in the middle of what's supposed to be my girlfriend and what's supposed to be my mother.
Got it.
And like, you, if you like really look at the trailer, it's like she's kind of like on my back, like the mother figure is like on my back, and then I'm like wrapped around the girl.
Got it.
The girlfriend figure.
Now, so, is that speaking to something specific that you as a young man are dealing with, kind of like this transition of having this main woman in your life to being in relationships?
Yeah, it plays on the, you know, because mainly so far I've been, my music's been about women.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it kind of gives it a reason to the madness and sense of like you have the mother connected to me while I'm holding on to the girl. So it's like, is there influence of some sort of how he was raised? Is why he's, you know, making these songs about these women and his experiences with these women, does that have some sort of influence? So it's kind of for, you know, I kind of wanted the viewers and the fans to really like dissect it a little bit.
Okay.
And just, you know, trying to take what they can from it for the most part. But that's the general theory.
Tell us about issues if people haven't pieced together everything you're doing. Mm-hmm. Tell us about issues before we play it.
Yeah, issues is it's one of my most personal records in terms of how what I went through as a child. You know, with I was raised with my grandmother for the most part, and then I kind of flipped around. I was with my mom for a stint. I just kind of flipped around houses a lot, so it kind of you know, people don't really know that, you know, coming off of Die for My Bitch and whatever. So I kind of, that song was really personal. And then Gorgeous is just about literally the winner.
I'm not one of those people that's like, if an artist don't want to have a conversation, I'm appreciative that we having a conversation. But I also know that you don't do a lot of conversations.
Yeah.
Is there a particular reason that you're, you know, careful about where you sit down and where you talk? Other than maybe not liking it at all?
I like it, though. It's, you know, it's kind of fun. You know, it's fun to get my perspective out there. So, like, especially with me, it's so many, it's so much talk that, you know, I don't really say much. So it's so much talk around me. And so I get to finally, you know, speak my piece about it and move on. But I think it's important to sit down. I like doing these. It's just, it's important to just pick, you know, people that really, you know, care about the subject at hand and, you know, can really have a valid conversation.
I appreciate being a part of that.
Yeah, no, for sure.
Well, I definitely, one of the first things that hit me about you as an artist was, you know, and when I first heard of you, I didn't know you had anything to do with Kendrick.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I hadn't, because I don't read the blogs like that. Like, I might see a headline or something.
Yeah.
And if it's a music artist kind of thing or somebody I'm listening to, I just go listen to it. I don't really, I want to see if I can actually figure out who this person is by what they're conveying in the music, right? What the depth is. And I heard depth there. Mm-hmm. I also heard style, right? Like your Die For My Bitch. I heard, you know, I didn't know until this album that you was producing records.
Oh, yeah, a lot of people
did. So I had to go back and go, oh, he did this. Like, I didn't know how heavily you was into the Black Panther joint.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that. So I'm kind of like, was just appreciative of you sounding like you're pulling from what's popular and the things that you were influenced by. Also pulling from, you know, you have some Kendrick elements, but you also have like, I hear, you know, some Young Thug. I hear some, a lot of, talk about your influences, because that's very hip hop, right? Like, a lot of people think being influenced is biting or copying, and that's not what that, but there's deliberate biting and copying, and then there's like, I'm gonna borrow from this and this and this and make something new, which is what I hear you doing.
Yeah, thank
you. So talk about those influences.
Damn, I love that you like picked that up.
Yeah.
That's how I feel. I feel like that's how everybody is, like, in music, you know? Like, influences-wise, though, I love Uzi.
Mm-hmm. I can hear it.
I love Cardi.
Yeah.
I love Dot.
Mm-hmm.
Trav. That's just, like, right now. But growing up, like, I was really on Kanye.
Right, I hear that. I hear that in the production for sure. Like the hard, especially in the bass lines that you're picking and how aggressive some of the music is too.
Yeah,
and
it's
soulful,
a certain feeling that I get. Yeah, it's a certain feeling. I can't explain it. You know, I talk about this with Dizzle a lot.
Mm.
It's like this feeling you get when you hear something.
Mm.
And I don't know if many people could feel that, because I listen to music sometimes and I'm like, there's no feeling here.
Mm.
But maybe that's just me. I don't know if, but anyway, that's a theory for another day. But, yeah, I could keep going on and on, like 3K.
There's an intangible that I don't think gets discussed enough or taught enough in the creation and recording of music, which might be what you're talking about with the feeling, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's like a piano player, right? You know, you could sit down at a piano and you can hit the notes. bing, bong, bing, bling, boom, yeah. bing, bing, bing. And then you can sit down really? And you can lean the same instrument with the mm-hmm. same keys. You can play with a different feeling, and the instrument will convey
yeah.
the feeling
right.
by what you, which is, I think, the magic of the way it's the human and the instrument connect.
It's crazy.
But the same thing goes when you're on an MPC
mm-hmm.
or on Ableton, or you, you know what I'm saying, or you're recording your voice and how you, whatever you're doing into the mechanism you're yeah. choosing to convey your creation. And I think that's what you're saying, right? Like
yeah.
you can hear the difference between somebody being like, I just want to make something because I just yeah. want to make something versus yeah. I need to make something and I need this to be heard because it's important for yeah. people to feel this thing. Like there's yeah. a...
It's important, man. If my ear don't pick up that feeling and when I hear some chords, because I really go off chords. Like, and
you play instruments?
I wish, but I'm really good at picking what I like.
Okay.
So
you can sit down at a keyboard and
yeah,
find
all day
a melody,
long. That's my
baseline.
Favorite thing to do. That's how I did the Melodic Blue, to be honest with you. It was all just, you know, sitting with Jahan and multiple composers and just really just picking through and you know.
A real producer is what you're saying. You sound like a real producer. Somebody
yeah,
knows
for sure.
how to bring something to life.
Yeah, and then it's bringing other producers in the room and just knowing their strong points and really like getting the best out of them and then knowing how to simplify the record to where it's, you know, because you could go tap on a bunch of drums and it's not really listenable.
Mm-hmm.
So you knowing how to simplify the record for the consumer and just doing all that. And then also, you know, putting drums myself where I see fit.
How did you learn this? Because what you're talking about is a specific skill that not a lot of people have at your age. So how did you, A, know that this was important, and B, where'd you learn it?
It was an accident. Because when I started rapping, I didn't have beats.
Mm.
And I was recording myself in, like, my auntie's bedroom, because that's who I was standing with at the time.
Mm.
And, I just remember them being like, you should just make beats. Like, that's, like, Kanye made beats. You should make beats. That's tight. And I'm like, oh, I don't know how to make a beat. Like, and so I just started recording myself in FL Studio.
Mm.
And then along the way, I started building a beat around my vocals. And then so that taught me how to like build a song around vocals. And so
did your interest, like you said earlier in our combo, you said I study all the time, paying attention to movies, I'm paying attention to the actor.
Yeah.
I guess you were also studying like the beginning, middle, and end of songs. Like why did the song do this here, do that there, and end here?
Yep.
Why did the movie
exactly
end here? Why
the
did
beginning,
they
middle,
like
end
this?
Of songs, the beginning, middle, end of careers, all that. I've studied all that for sure. I think it's important because at the end of the day, it's like I'm a student, and once I figured out I didn't like school, then I had to put that, you know, somewhere else. So I was a good student for the most part, and then...
But not out of love, out of necessity.
Out of necessity, but then I figured out what I loved, and then I took that, and I became a bad student, but then I became a great student in music. So.
Right, right, right.
And then from there, I just did that all day, every day. Until
you eat a lot of... on your album. Have you noticed that? That's a reoccurring theme.
You know what? When you in it...
And somebody always on my man's face. He got his mouth on something.
Man, orange soda, everything.
Yeah.
You know, when you in it, you know...
Listen, if that's your thing, God bless you.
I'm trying to get the beer like you, man.
It could help. It could help, but it might not, you know?
You
can catch some other things if you're not careful.
No, I'm careful. I'm super. I don't do nothing. I don't kiss.
You know?
If I don't kiss you, it's over.
Yeah. But now, talk about that, though, because it's in a lot of records, though. Like, and once again, and, you know, removing sexuality and what your interests are in sex and all that.
Yeah.
But just the appreciation of women.
Yeah.
You know, the women you're interested in and even the women you're not interested in.
Yeah.
And talk about that because I'm sure you have a lot of women asking you about lyrics to songs or why you said this.
It's funny. I was raised by women.
Right.
Like, literally. The only man that was probably around was my uncle.
Mm-hmm.
And then later on, my stepdad, but get into that later. But, yeah, I was raised by women, so it's kind of funny, like, when they hear the music and that, like,
were you, like, nervous at first to, like, how your mom or aunties hear it?
No, because I was like, I wanted the music to express myself at the end of the day, and you ain't gonna get nowhere by not expressing yourself.
But so, it had to be in the back of your mind, like,
a little bit. But it's kind of funny too,
like, it played and you kind of looked over at them, like,
yeah, a little bit, and it's like, y'all gotta get with it, because I got a funny family, like, they kind of,
oh, so they talk
funny, okay. So, like, it kind, it ain't that deep, like, they not, like, you know,
it's not language like, they haven't heard, or it's like, not, yeah,
like,
yeah,
they taught me that language, right, so right. You know what I mean, like. They funny as hell, but women are really important to the society, obviously.
Right.
But you know, like, I believe in many feminist ideologies. Like, you know, I think that the president should be a woman right now. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I think it's due past time. So, and my music is funny because it's like a contradiction. Mm-hmm. But that's kind of the art of it. You know, it's you know, I have songs like First Order of Business, but then I also have songs like Think I Got a Sense for a Mosh Pit, mm-hmm. where I say likes on the gram make a bitch think she popping. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's just playing in that middle line of just, you know, just being creative. And,
well, it's also just human, right? Like, talking and it's your human. Shit and being human and
it's
being
real emotions, you know, yeah, for sure. Like,
that Lost Souls with Brent Faiyaz, mm-hmm. you know, listen, he's on fire out here. Crazy.
Insane.
I love the collab. Talk about that relationship. How did y'all link? And then tell us why you added these three songs.
Man, first off, Brent's a superstar. Yeah. He's really dope. Cool dude. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? He was just so down. And it was a thing where it was like, damn, I had the album like a whole year ago, year and a half ago, and I met him in the studio, like, randomly. And I played him for, I think I had like 16 at the time, like songs like that. And he was just like, damn, like, this is hard. And then we linked up after that, and then we wanted to connect on a record, but it never really happened. So then recently, I'm like, yo, the album about to get turned in now, because, like, I just need you on the album, bro. Like, I don't care how, whatever you want to do, I need you on the album because you're one of my favorite artists. And so, you know, he was down. He was like, yeah, like, I was like, yeah, bro, I'm mad that you ain't even on the album. At this point, like, you should have been on the album, you know what I mean? But it's fire because he came through for me, and, you know, it was a deadline too. So he's really solid for that. Like, I told him I got like 8 days. So I ended up getting added late, but I figured it was a good time to add Hooligan and No Sense too, because those were originally,
those records is fire too.
Yeah, those were originally on the album, but they came out as singles. And you know how I get when you drop a single, it's like kind of, it's like, ah, do I feel like putting this on the album now? Like, you know, I've been out, the world didn't heard it. And then, you know, I kind of wanted my album to be a little shorter originally.
Got it.
And so, but originally those were made for the album in context. They kind of got taken off last minute. So.
Just because you felt like they was dated.
I feel like people heard it already. Yeah, if you want to hear it, you can go hear it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So the album, I wanted it to be like mainly new songs.
But know? I think sometimes when you got to make sure that things are categorized correctly,
mm-hmm.
10 years from now.
Exactly. You know, so I think that's why it was important to add it back.
Wait, how would this fit in the whole story?
Yeah.
You know?
That's why I wanted to make a point to add it back.
Right.
Because I was like, okay, now that the first few weeks are done, settled, we can add these songs.
Hooligan's fire. Was you even on Hooligan?
Yeah.
Yeah, you did again on Hooligan.
Yeah, I believe
right?
so.
Yeah, it's crazy. Give this guy going in. No wonder the ladies love this dude, man. Listen, he's not ashamed. Go off, my guy. As a producer, now when I go back and understand that you've been doing a lot of work that I just wasn't even looking at the credits and understanding who you was. In the production of
mm-hmm.
Black Panther and other things. Talk us through the decision, because you do it kind of frequently, to change the beat in the middle of a song.
Right.
Right? And you know, A, why? B, what do you want us to learn from you as a producer when you do that? Like, what are you thinking? Because, you know, as your story grows, us that are appreciating your art and we become more and more fans, mm-hmm. now we're trying to follow the art. Method. We're trying to follow, like, oh, he did that. He said when he does this. Is there something in there for us to learn about you?
It stems from a from too many records originally. Like,
what do you
mean? When you sit down and make beats all day long and you just have you kinda just going and you know exactly what you want, and then sometimes you may get something that's left field. You're like, damn, like, I got this, though. And you're like, but is this a hard song on its own? Or is this, like, can it go somewhere else?
Right.
So it's a level of knowing, like, you know, like the switch up has to be better than the first part every time. So if you're going to switch it up, it can't be a worse record.
So you're trying to take us as the listener on a higher plane. Yeah. Is the
and then
aim.
I think about live too. Like it's main, like live, it goes crazy.
Right.
Like it goes so crazy. So, you know, it's just building that into the album as well. Because originally with this album, I wanted to attack a very piano chords, like, you know, really blue sound, if that makes sense. You know, really, really in that sad feeling.
I don't know if people, it sounds like you're...
Like records like Issue, 16, right. Scars, Scapegoats.
Right.
Like I want to really, really, really go there. With
I'm not sure that everybody, it's universally understood that the color blue, the word blue, and blues and R&B.
Yeah.
And I think is it the B flat chord? Is that what it is?
Probably
that
so.
A lot of that music was built around. There's like a specific chord
that's like
that takes you into that melodic blue, if you will.
Like Nina Simone.
Right.
Like Kanye West's when he sampled Nina Simone, like that first part.
Mm-hmm.
Like that, those chords feel blue to me.
Right.
You know? But whatever.
And blue meaning almost moody, in a moody blue.
Very moody. That's the perfect word.
And not dark, but melancholy,
not dark,
if you will.
Maybe sad-ish.
Yeah, maybe sad, but not quite upset.
Mm-hmm. Sad. It could be sad, uplifting, sad, and
right,
something
right,
like
right.
that. But, you know, I wanted to play it in that world. And but I also wanted to play in the world of the stage. So that's where records like Trademark you know, records like that come from Fall in Love. And so it's just, it was fun building those two worlds because those are two different worlds. So you got songs. But, you know, it worked out because, you know, the people's favorites so far are like the 16s, the Issues, and, you know, the actual blue songs to me. So it like really worked out in it.
And you still got the turn
and
up
I still
records.
Have the stage records.
Yeah, the stage records. South Africa. The record starts with piano chords.
Yeah.
And I was... You know, I obviously am a fan of this music coming out of South Africa called I'm a Piano. So when you start the records, I was like, yo, is he about to go straight, you know, South African production?
Yeah.
But you spent time out there, obviously, and worked with artists when y'all was working on Black Panther. So talk about this song, when you wrote it. Now what was that? 2 years ago, 3 years ago, the Black Panther soundtrack.
To be real, I never went to South Africa.
Oh, you didn't?
I never been to Africa.
Really?
I want to go.
Man,
it's
gotta happen.
I wanted to shoot a video out there.
Yeah.
And it just never happened. You know, COVID kind of messed it up a little bit. But I want to go out there and just really explore.
No,
like,
you'd love it.
Just chill, you know.
They got amazing producers out there,
and they show love. I just felt it was right to just, you know, put them in a song because they were like one of the first like international Marcus to really like be in my DMs. Like,
yo,
I seen that more than anything.
Scene, yo, the hip hop scene is crazy.
Crazy out there.
Yo, South Africa's hip hop scene is so healthy.
Man, I can't wait to get out there and just really like just go out there for like a few weeks and just kick it.
When you create, what happens first? It's all beats. You just got beats upon beats and ideas. And
when I want to make some, I'll sit down and just make a bunch of beats. And then if that don't work, then
and
I'll try
beats,
something else.
You mean straight up drums and bass lines?
Like literally like everything.
Okay, so you mean a full production package?
Yeah, like Orange Soda. Like I did that whole joint in my room. So I'll just sit down and just make a bunch of beats I'll freestyle on them and then I'll save them. And then I'll come back to it later if it's fire and then we'll do post-production. With the room, or sometimes I'll just start and cook from scratch with the whole room, and then I'll run in and we'll do jam sessions and things like that. Kind of like a band,
right?
You know,
that's how it should be cooked up, and then sample from that. And
that's where some
that
of my best
rearrange.
Music comes
yeah.
from, like Honest and you know, especially songs off the new project. But you know, most of my personal music comes from that.
Yeah,
it's kind of crazy
because you have more to pull from. There's more energy in the room to help
and
you
just
kinda,
go. You just go like 200 ideas in one night, and then you just burn yourself out. You do that for like 3 nights, you good.
And then
that's like half. That's like half the album right there.
And then you just edit it down, rearrange.
And then you take what you like, then you go write, then you come back.
Love
Then you redo the drums. You do whatever you need to do, record by record. And then all of a sudden you just got records.
So then that means what Don Tolliver was telling me, the magic that y'all have.
Yeah.
Cause that's kind of similar. He like he's a straight vibes and writing and
yeah,
you know what I mean. Coming up with an idea. This record Coco's fire, but he said, and then obviously you got a record with him
yeah.
on his project. But he said y'all had a bunch of work that y'all put Man. Together.
It's we just building, you know. He's like really like the first solid person I connected with, like really really. And then you know obviously I have more solid people now, but like he's really cool like. And so I was just like, damn, like, he just pulled up and just did the record. Like, no.
No politics, yeah, no like, hectic.
That was cool. Like, I didn't have to worry about it.
Right.
So then after that, I was like, damn, yeah, this dude's solid.
Right. Did you expect Orange Soda?
Yeah.
To go
yeah.
as far as it did?
Yeah.
How'd you know?
Because I found myself driving to school, because I was still in high school when I made that song. And I was writing to it. Like, wild drive. Like, it was really urgent because I made the beat like at like 2 a.m. and then I fell asleep. I had to probably wake up like at 5 and I got right to it. And I was writing that song all day in class. Like,
no wonder your grades was fucked up.
Yeah, no, it was. I was sleeping like in class going Damn, crazy.
Because all night you was up
yeah,
making beats.
I started getting C's and shit.
Damn.
Which is cool.
By the it way, worked. He up here, that's how smart this guy is. He just said, I was making C's. You know how many parents wish their kids start making C's was bad. I want to range brothers shooting with your brother on the range, Kendrick Lamar.
Yeah.
He's on two songs on the album.
Mm-hmm.
When Kendrick appears on a Baby Keem album, is that because he hears some shit and he's like, this ain't getting out the door without me because this is so crazy, I got to be on it?
Yeah.
Or is young cousin like, yo, big cousin, jump on this joint?
Man, I leave it up to him, man, because at the end of the day.
So it is that it's so fire, he want
to
be on it.
I leave it up to him because it's a thing where it's like, we so, like I kind of picked this up from him a little bit where we just change all the time.
Mm.
So he'll be on one record and then next day he'll be on the next record. Like, so we was in a perfect spot where we felt the music was really high tier to that point, and you know, he just really got to pick what he wanted to do.
Got it. Well, of the two, Family Ties and Range Brothers, do you have a particular one that you like more than the other?
Man.
Because they're very different, by the way, but the
yeah.
records.
Family Ties was funny because originally I wasn't going to put it on because it wasn't the Family Ties we all know. It was like the first beat, and then it was some raps.
Mm-hmm.
But it was cool. It was some cool raps. And then, but, you know, Dot and everybody in the studio was just like, man, that song. But I'm like, you know, I'm stubborn. So I'm like, nah, I don't know.
Y'all will disagree like that. Well, he'll say, yeah, yo, this is fire. You'll be like, yo, that shit ain't that dope.
It'll never be like all the way opposite. Like,
yeah.
I'll see. Because I get it. But it'll mostly be like, damn, I kind of have a song like that that's doing that already.
Right.
You know what I mean? Or it'll be like, that. More so than disagreeing on the song in the whole. Because
right.
I with the song because I made it.
Right.
So it's like, you know, but
I like it, but you like it more than I like it.
Yeah, like you like it for this reason, but I don't like it for because I'm in my head about something that right. the fans might not even know. That's usually what it be, but you know, we ended up really taking out like revisiting the song and doing it. And then when I laid, like I did like probably three verses on that joint and it was crazy, and it ended up just being the colossal verse.
Right.
And then the second part ended up, we had like this beat stash that we had for rainy days. It's funny, like, it'd be a
what
beat
you mean
drop.
For rainy days?
Rainy day beats.
Like when the creative is kind of like when y'all just need some inspiration.
Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, Cardo, he be flooding beats to the both of us. So, you know, he's all in that folder. So we was just like, damn, it'd be crazy like if this just went to this. And like you just went crazy with the verse. Cause originally that verse was on the same beat.
Got it.
It was crazy. And
the change helps. The change helps.
And it helped the entire thing and it made it a thing. But Range Brothers is like, you know, the first two parts. I had the first two parts. And then like we really came together on that third part. And then it was just crazy. So I think the most fun making was Range Brothers for sure.
The imagery of the album and that's a pier that you're sitting on, or is that like a floating
Yeah. We had built
a dock
a,
of some sort? Or?
Yeah, we built like a dock
Okay. Yeah. Oh, so that was just built for this?
Yeah, like that wasn't even Photoshop. Like the dot was real, like the colors were really like painted on there.
And why, what was the, what? Tell us what you're trying. Is this kind of like an isolation?
Yeah, sure. It's like reflecting, but it's also a concept that we have coming in the future that I kind of can't really like, I don't want to get it too
late. Don't spoil it.
But you know, I kind of want to do a little play in. It'll make more sense in a few months.
So the this album is going to be tied to more releases soon come.
I hope so.
What I hear you saying.
I hope so. Nothing's set in stone right now, but that's the plan. That's the plan for sure.
Like, and how many music videos are you going to do off this album? Since I know y'all, between you and Dave Free and K-Dot and everything that y'all got production-wise and all that, feel like y'all could shoot a movie if y'all wanted to right now. Y'all could do whatever the fuck y'all want. I mean, as far as, you know what I mean? It's not like you got to wait.
There's really no limit.
Yeah, there's no boundaries on you. You can be like, yo, I'm going to shoot a music video for every song.
Yeah.
If you wanted to.
Yeah, that was the plan, to be honest with you. Like, okay. That's the plan for every album I make. You know, I love shooting visuals. Like, I don't know what it is. It's just when you see the final product, it's just fun, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it all makes it worth it. But I think, I don't know. I think we'd probably do one or two more. And
for this album.
We'll go one at a time and see, you know, what the people really love.
I want to get into Do-Rag Activity. I think this was like the first single.
Yeah, I think so.
Or was it even a single at that time? Or was it just a Lucy at the time?
No, it was a single for sure. It was a single for sure. You know, everything's so space between because, you know, it's just figuring out that right time to really come. And it ended up working out really perfect for us. But, yeah, it doesn't feel like it was a single, but it does.
Right.
it was a single.
How did you meet Trav? Like, how did that relationship happen? And did you... Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, obviously Don Toliver works with him and they cook up for Cactus Jack's.
Yeah.
Did you know Trav first?
I think so. It's all a blur kind of for me right now.
It's a good thing you don't smoke or drink because...
Yeah, I can't remember now. Like,
exactly. Exactly. You got to keep you sober.
that's probably why, too. But, I think I met Trav first. Mm. He reached out to my friend Brock, my good friend.
I got it.
And we connected through him. And then I pulled up like later that week and I just played him the album. He played me what he had going on and it kind of came together. He picked Do-Rag and he jumped on it and showed love. He was the first really to like jump on the album and really put his foot
out there. You know, he could hear, his ears is crazy. Like another guy who's amazing on the production as well.
Man, the best artists are A&Rs, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Facts.
It's like
they
literally.
Know how to push together.
Yeah.
On the way out, first of all, everybody go get this Melodic Blue. A lot of people talking about it, but it's great for you to give us some context too, because I think the other thing that K-Dot has incorporated from kind of the hip-hop lexicon, if you will, is his ability to change voices.
Yeah.
And use different personalities.
Right.
Which you're borrowing that and making that a part of your aesthetic, which I applaud. I think it's very creatively very important and also... creates a larger playground.
Yeah, for sure.
You know what I'm saying? To create these characters and voices and textures and all of that. How did you find yours? Was that just trial and error? You know, I feel like on Die For My Bitch, there wasn't as many as there were on this Melodic Blue. Like, you feels like you stepped out a little bit even more on Melodic Blue also.
Yeah, I definitely experimented on that part, I guess you could say. I don't know. I guess I got this word from, like, Twitter and shit, that the experiment word, but I would call it like growth,
right?
More so, but I'll just say experiment for, you know, regular sake.
Well, yeah, because it's not experimental. It definitely feels like I want y'all to meet a different texture of my voice. I want y'all to feel a different feeling.
Exactly. Like, I'm confident, so I'm not experimenting. Like, you know, I feel like experiment is like you're not confident.
I'm trying and seeing if it lands.
Yeah,
that's
like
what
I think this album is growth more so. I know I said it earlier too, like. It's a lot of voices in that studio, man.
Yeah.
That haven't seen the light. It's a lot of characters too. Like, you really like embody a character on that mic. Like, I'm this right now.
Right. And the jam session that you're doing in some of this creative process, I'm sure is probably helping with that. Because you can pull out a different energy when you
can really just have fun. That's really the importance of a jam session. There's no pressure. You go in there, you can make one song. You go in there and make 5. You go in there and make 100 ideas.
Just warming up, you come up with 25 different ideas. Just getting in the boogie for the evening.
Exactly. So it's just like, and just getting the mic hot. you know? Mm-hmm. Like, it all plays a part, so. And it's just raw emotion of that day just coming out and you sharing it with the people, you know, you really vulnerable with. And this, everybody's vulnerable. Everybody's doing something they're not sure about, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, from the composer to the guy who's doing drums to me to, you know, vocals, engineer. Like, everybody, no one's sure in a jam session. That's what makes it so beautiful, I think.
Right.
Like, everybody's insecure about something. Like, am I, damn, do they with this? Or,
right.
If I'm, you know, if I'm playing the drums, it's like.
And then somebody be like, yo, hold that right there. Don't change nothing. Leave that right there.
And then it all just comes together. Right. And it's just like, that's the beauty of it. And that's what makes it fun to me, I think. Yeah. For sure.
But, yo, man, it's been a pleasure meeting you, man.
Yeah. Yeah, you as well, man. We've been talking for a minute.
Yeah.
We've been in and out for a minute.
Yeah, man.